Hi friends, welcome to the NPTEL course Leadership for India Inc. Practical Concepts and Constructs. We are in week 12 discussing legendary leadership. In this lecture we will focus on J.R.D. Tata bringing out his model of conglomerate leadership, which is beyond compare. J.R.D. Tata, considered the legendary patriarch of Tata Group, was a true leader of leaders. He was a great entrepreneur. J.R.D. Tata had 14 enterprises under Tata Sons when he started his tenure at the helm in 1938, at a young age of 34 years. Half a century later, he expanded it into a highly respected conglomerate of 95 enterprises operating in every industry. J.R.D. Tata, the foremost industrialist and philanthropist of India, will be always remembered for his multi-decade leadership of Tata Group. He placed India on the aviation map of the world and played a major part in the development of Tata Group, synchronizing with the growth of India as an industrial power. He had a positive zest for life and a compassionate concern for people. J.R.D.'s passing away in 1993, which received press coverage worth a prime minister, shows his contribution to the development of India and to the image of India on an international level. Let's consider the amazing growth of Tata Group. This growth, spanning over 150 years under multi-generational leadership, can be considered in four phases. Obviously, only a few highlights could be stated here. The first was the Jamsetji Tata era. The Tata Group was founded as a private trading firm in 1868 by entrepreneur and philanthropist Jamsetji Nasirwani Tata. In 1902, the group incorporated the Indian Hotels Company to commission the Taj Mahal Palace and Tower, the first luxury hotel in India, which opened the following year. After Jamsetji's death in 1904, his son Sir Dorab Tata took over as chair of the Tata Group. Under Dorab's leadership, the group quickly diversified, venturing into a vast array of new industries, including steel, 1907, electricity, 1910, education, 1911, consumer goods, 1917, and aviation, 1932. Following Dorab's death in 1932, Sir Noraji Saklatwala became the group's chair. In 1925, Jahangir Ratanji Dadabhai Tata, called J.R.D. Tata by us affectionately, joined Tata Sons as an apprentice. In 1938, the J.R.D. Tata era started. In that year, J.R.D. Tata was elected to the position of chairman of Tata Sons. His continued expansion of the group into new sectors such as chemicals, 1939, technology, 1945, cosmetics, 1952, wider marketing, engineering and manufacturing, 1954, tea, 1962, and software services, 1968, earned Tata Group international recognition. In 1945, Tata Group established Tata Engineering and Locomotive Company to manufacture engineering and locomotive products. Telco began manufacturing trucks in 1954. The Ratan Tata era started in 1991. In that year, JRD's nephew Ratan Tata succeeded JRD as chairman of the Tata Group. Upon assuming the leadership of the conglomerate, Ratan Tata aggressively sought to expand it. He increasingly focused on globalizing the group businesses. In 2000, the group acquired London-based Tetley Tea, and in 2004, it purchased the truck manufacturing operations of South Korea's Daewoo Motors. In 2001, Tata Group partnered with American International Group Inc., AIG, to create the insurance company Tata AIG. The group acquired European steel major Corus in 2006 and famed global automobile mark Jaguar Land Rover in 2008. Some of these aspects we considered in earlier lectures as well. More information on these can be found in the reference I have cited. While all the legendary Tatas made unique contributions to the evolution of Tata Group, J.R.D. Tata's five-decade tenure at the helm truly laid extremely robust foundation for the first truly global conglomerate group from India. Although born into an aristocratic family and educated in several countries abroad, J.R.D. Tata developed a strong bond with India and became a highly nationalistic entrepreneur and industrialist. Born to Ratanji Dadabhai Tata and his French wife Suni, J.R.D. Tata spent most of his childhood in France. His education was disrupted periodically. He was schooled in Paris, India, and Japan. Language was one of the major problems that he faced due to the heritage and upbringing. After the passing of his mother, J.R.D. Tata was sent to Cranmer in England prior to his admission in Cambridge. His plan to join Cambridge never materialized as the French passed a law of conscription that made him to serve the military compulsorily. J.R.D. Tata always regretted of not having a university degree and specializing in a particular field. This regret made him to try harder and be determined in whatever he did. It is evident from his life history that he excelled in many fields even without a formal education. It was the dream of Jamsetji Tata that India should erect a steel plant, a hydroelectric network and a university of science. It was his family and other loyal colleagues who made his dream come true. J.R.D. Tata played a most significant part in that. As an industrialist, J.R.D. believed in taking care of his workers and serving as trustee for public wealth. J.R.D. Tata wanted India to be a happy country and did all that he could to make it happen. J.R.D. Tata was verily the aviation pioneer for India. He was the first ever Indian to receive the commercial pilot's license in 1929, 10 years after his first joyride in Hadelot. He was a risk taker. He got himself into deep difficulty while self-teaching to be an acrobatics pilot, as he felt that having a mere license would not make him a good and safe pilot. He was born with a mechanical mind. Though J.R.D. Tata did not have formal training, his mechanical mind made him a great pilot, for he knew without many refinements. He was also a very competent map reader. With a faulty compass, J.R.D. Tata was able to complete the Aga Khan challenge only because he was a good map reader. And he had several natural required qualities. Judgment, capacity to keep cool, coordination and trust were some of the qualities that J.R.D. acquired as a pilot, which helped him as he handled and developed a great industrial empire. He was an inspiration to many budding and accomplished aeronauts. Kalpana Chawla, a well-known astronaut, was one among them, who cited that J.R.D. Tata was her inspiration to take up aeronautics. J.R.D. Tata was a person who had vision that was backed by execution. Great business leaders need to walk the fine line between capitalizing on the opportunities that are ripe for the present context and planning for a possible future state, and J.R.D. Tata excelled in that. There was a vision and there was also an achievement. Even though the aviation industry was not making much profit initially, J.R.D. Tata had a vision of a bright and expanding future for the same. The key for J.R.D. was to prove to the skeptical British government that an Indian firm could run air services, which he did, and received the mail carriage business from the British government. J.R.D. Tata's vision was to launch Tata Airlines to the west, where the real air traffic existed. Air India International was formally incorporated on 8 March 1948, and its first service from Bombay to London was inaugurated on 8 June the same year. J.R.D. Tata had great dreams of developing India's economy by making it grow rapidly into an industrial power and creating millions of jobs every year for its people. Tata Group ventured into chemicals, automobiles, tea, information technology and watches, and many more industries under the leadership and guidance of J.R.D. Tata. In almost 52 years under the chairmanship of J.R.D. Tata, Tata Group expanded its footprint across highly diversified and technology-intensive businesses. He had economic and social vision. The life of J.R.D. Tata is notable not only for exceptionally growing the Tata business and industrial empire, but also for nurturing and establishing multiple institutions in the academic, social, healthcare, and cultural fields. Under J.R.D. Tata's chairmanship, the assets of the Tata Group grew from USD 100 million to over USD 5 billion. He started, as I said, with 14 enterprises under his leadership in 1938, and half a century later, on 26 July 1988, when he left his position, Tata Sons was a conglomerate of 95 enterprises, which the group either started or in which group had controlling interest. J.R.D. was the trustee of the Sir Dorabji Trust, Tata Trust, from its inception in 1932 for over half a century. Under his guidance, the trust established Asia's first cancer hospital, the Tata Memorial Center for Cancer Research and Treatment in Bombay in 1941. He also founded the Tata Institute of Social Sciences in 1936, the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research in 1945, and the National Center for Performing Arts in 1969. J.R.D. Tata was held in the highest respect by the Indian industry, society and the government. He received the Indian government's second highest civilian award, Padma Vibhushan, in 1955. He also received India's highest civilian honor, Bharat Ratna, in 1992. He received several national and international awards and recognitions. J.R.D. Tata's industrialization had foresight and vision. The Economic Times, dated 27 December 1990, listed the top companies of India asset-wise, on which Tata Steel ranked number 1, Telco number 4, and Tata Chemicals number 10. Such accomplishments came about as JRD believed in partnering with highly capable leaders and nurturing them to high performance. Three examples are cited here. First, Tata Chemicals. It was a brainchild of Manchester-trained engineer Kapil Ram Vakil. It was established only because of JRD Tata's willingness to support innovation. JRD Tata supported Sir Dorabji Tata Trust to approve Dr. Homi Bhabha's proposal for the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, which became the cradle of India's atomic program. It was due to Sumant Malgaonkar's management and JRD Tata's visionary leadership that Telco, now Tata Motors, became a great success. There are several other examples as well. He partnered with F.C. Kohli to establish Tata Consultancy Services and create the icon of software industrialization in India. A true leader, JRD Tata not only had his own vision but also supported his people's vision to a great extent. JRD believed in learning and development of his employees passionately. Amongst various in-house management centers and external development institutions, Tata Management Training Center was consistently ranked high. I could only represent a few cases here, but Tata Group being what it is indeed difficult to capture all the companies, all the enterprises in one lecture. When India was emerging from the yoke of colonialism, JRD Tata ushered an era of rapid industrialization by laying foundation to multiple companies. Even the few companies represented here are enough to show the diversity which he conceptualized. Tata Motors, as I said, was founded in 1945 as Telco, and it emerged as one of the largest automotive companies in the world, with its operations in several countries of the world apart from India. Air India, founded in 1932 as Tata Airlines, was one of the greatest airlines at that point of time in the world, built with passion and personal care by JRD Tata. Tata Consultancy Services was a testament to the vision of JRD Tata. TCS, founded in 1968, is the first Indian company to breach $100 billion market capitalization. Tata Salt, launched in 1983, has become the biggest packaged salt brand in India with a market share of 17%. Tata Chemicals Limited, with the support of JRD Tata, the company which faced several hurdles, began operating in 1944 and is now the world's second largest maker of soda ash and is now set to enter into exotic fields such as electric batteries. Tata Steel, the flagship of Tata Group, was developed by him. Tata Steel, of course, was founded by TISCO, by Jamsetji Tata and Dorabji Tata in 1907. However, JRD took Tata Steel to great heights. Titan is another shining example of his partnership with great leaders. Founded in 1986 as a joint venture with TITCO and as partnership between Xerox Desai and JRD Tata, today Titan is the Tata Group's largest consumer organization, having diversified into jewelry, optical devices and other luxury items. Lakme is the number one cosmetic brand in India, again was founded by JRD Tata in 1952. JRD Tata founded TIS in 1990, much ahead of the current digital flavor. It is now the only digital education company to be assessed at level 5 in both PCMM and SCICMM frameworks. Tata Global Beverages was founded in 1964. Even after suffering a tumultuous gestation period, the company became the world's second largest manufacturer of tea. It has now evolved into Tata Consumer Products, taking into fold some of the consumer products of Tata Chemicals. This small dipstick into what happened at Tata Group during the 5-decade tenure of JRD Tata is indicative of his enterprise, his entrepreneurship and his ability to manage a conglomerate to great heights. Let's look at Tata Consultancy Services as a shining example of JRD Tata's business foresight. Long before computerization became a movement, Tata envisaged and established TCS. The company became the icon of India's talent in Indian software and information technology services. TCS, along with Infosys, Wipro, and other companies which followed, made India a global powerhouse in IT industry with multiple domain solutions. During 1968, when computers were being looked at with awe as well as apprehension, JRD Tata established TCS. He realized the need for an exclusive venture to harness the capabilities of computers to serve the industry and the economy. Under the leadership of F.C. Cowley, who served as the CEO of TCS from 1969 to 1996, TCS flourished to become India's first billion-dollar company and also keep maintaining that growth momentum. TCS went public in 2004 with the rupees 5,000 crore giant IPO of the times opening coincidentally with the birth centenary of JRD Tata. The database as of 24-2018 illustrated how Tata Consultancy Services grew to become the most valuable company for the Tata Group and also within the industry. JRD Tata was certainly a role model in management. The Tatas were the first corporate organization in India and even globally perhaps to have a Department of Economics and Statistics and a Department of Public Relations in the early 1940s itself. JRD scripted many management initiatives at Tata Group. When he took over, he found major gaps in management like dependence on external resources for various legal, business and financial issues. He filled these gaps within 2 years of his taking over by spotting and appointing competent experts. Several of them continued to be great leaders in the Tata Group. J.D. Choksi was appointed as legal advisor and he rose to be vice chairman of Tata Steel and Air India. After securing the legal side, A.D. Shroff was appointed as the finance leader. JRD Tata started a statistical department due to lack of statistical information and appointed Y.S. Pandit, who served Tata's for the next 28 years. The Superior Staff Recruiting Committee was formed to recruit the best and young talents for Tata Group. JRD Tata established the group's own prestigious management school in 1956, from where top executives were sourced for Tata Administrative Services. The statistical outline of India put out by the Tata Group became a vital source of information to Indian business, industry, academia, and to government officials. As a corporate planner myself, I was extensively relying on the Tata's statistical outline of India to guide my thinking on the macroeconomic environment. JRD Tata was notable for taking his companies from hurdles to achievements. Some representative milestones of JRD era with reference to telco are presented here. JRD Tata gave Sumant Malgaonkar, the famed head of Tata Motors, complete freedom to function and grow, which helped to create an amazing indigenous automobile corporation for India. Ratan Tata made it globally competitive. In 1945, Telco was established. In 1954, it began collaborating with Daimler-Benz, West Germany, for manufacture of medium commercial vehicles. First exports were made in 1961. Direct ignition engines were introduced in 1971. Between 1977 and 1983, the first light commercial vehicles and heavy commercial vehicles were manufactured. In 1991, the 1 millionth vehicle rolled out. Between 1994 and 1997, the company broke new ground with the launch of sports utility vehicles and other intermediate commercial vehicles. Tata Sumo, LTP 709, Mercedes-Benz car, done in partnership, and Tata Sumo Deluxe were some of the high points. In 1998, the 2 millionth vehicle rolled out. In 2002, the launch of CNG buses, then Indica V2, second generation Indica, Tata Indigo, and Tata Sumo Plus series were launched. In 2003, Tata Engineering became Tata Motors Limited, and 3 millionth vehicle was produced. In 2004-08, in that period, Tata Motors got listed in New York Stock Exchange. The Tata Motors JRDQE Award for Business Excellence was another notable achievement. Tata Motors vehicle sales in India crossed 4 million mark. And Tata Motors unveiled Tata Nano, the people's car, which was an outstanding design concept, first time in India and as well as in the global automobile industry to have been conceived of a car with US$1,000 price tag, capable of carrying 5 people and also in hatchback version. Telco was first called Tata Locomotive and Engineering Company. The name was changed to Tata Engineering and Locomotive Company in September 1960, when the primary objects shifted from locomotives to trucks and general engineering. It became Tata Motors in 2003. I have recalled in my earlier lecture how JRD Tata served to strengthen the indigenous capabilities of Tata Motors, like acquiring and integrating press tool manufacturing capability by establishing new plants and by facilitating indigenous development of passenger cars and various other types of vehicles through foundational infrastructure developments. As I said, JRD Tata's tenure is notable for crossing hurdles and leading the companies to achievements. Tata Chemicals was one great example. It was launched in 1939 in Mithapur, but it could start production only by 1944. Lack of interest from the government, the failure of the first soda ash project, Salt Protection Act being withdrawn, township being affected by the World War, machinery getting sunk in the high seas, reputed American consultants going back on their word to strengthen the company. Tata Chemicals was another example of how Tata took many achievements. Tata Chemicals was a company that was launched in 1939 primarily to make soda ash. The company faced many troubles, and two things JRD did. The first thing was spotting Dabari Seth in a review meeting and placing his trust on him as the right person to save Tata Chemicals. The second was to be with Tata Chemicals through thick and thin to make sure that the company lived up to the purpose with which it was set up. As a result, although the production commenced late, it grew into a world-scale plant. It became one of the top 100 companies in India. Where Tata Chemicals was set up, there used to be a tough breed of people called Vaghis. But JRD Tata's congenial method of management and his ability to engage with the community made them appreciate and love him, and they became pillars of support to the company. And there lied JRD Tata's great humanism as well as industrial stewardship. Let us look at Tata Steel for reflecting on JRD Tata's leadership. The company was established in 1907. In 1910, TISCO, as it was called then, obtained its first colliery. In 1911-12, it started operations and production. All of these things, of course, happened much before JRD Tata took over. In 1938, JRD Tata becomes the chairman of Tata Steel, and manufacture of special steel got commenced in 1941. In 1955, the first major expansion program was done with Kaiser Engineers. In 1958, they created a whole township and Jubilee Park dedicated to the nation on completion of 50 years of Tata Steel's existence. In 1967, it brought the latest generation IBM 1401 systems for computerization in the company. In 1982-83, basic oxygen furnace shop was inaugurated. In 1994, it received the Prime Minister's Trophy for the best integrated steel plant. In 94-96, several new innovations were introduced in the company. And in 2007, London-based steel manufacturer Corus Group was acquired and Tata Steel Europe got established. Tata Group is perhaps the only private group in India to develop the whole campus as a city, Tata Nagar or Jamshedpur as it is called. Tata Steel created history in becoming the first and integrated steel plant in the world to win the Deming Prize in 2008 and Deming Grand Prize in 2012. Passion and commitment marked his leadership. When you have a passionate leader, the leader's staff also acquire the same passion. JRD's passion for work transcended across his organizations, enveloping all his staff. Air India won appreciation for customer service when he was at the helm. Though G.R.D. Tata was not a full-time chairman of Air India, he was fully involved in every aspect of the functioning of the airline. He always looked at aviation through the eyes of an industrialist. He worked with passion and commitment to make his two-part vision come true. One, Air India should always provide something unique to its customers. And two, air travel should be made into mass market and large-scale market by making it economical. On 1st August 1953, the Indian Parliament nationalized 9 privately owned airlines and clubbed them into state-owned corporations, Air India International and Indian Airlines. Even though G.R.D. Tata was against nationalization from the start, he agreed to be appointed as the chairman of Air India. He served with the same passion and commitment without any remuneration until he was separated by the government in the year 1977. G.R.D. Tata never worried about only profit. He always aimed at giving special and unique experience to his customers. From tea to seating to breakfast served, all minute details were noted. Suggestions for improvements were given. G.R.D. Tata agreed to be the chairman to maintain the standards of the airline that he had introduced from the start. He time and again proved to be a great leader with passion and commitment and never shut his eyes when something went wrong. The recent rocky history of Air India and the merged Indian Airlines demonstrates the importance of passionate and committed free enterprise leaders to the profitable growth and sustainable growth of large corporations. G.R.D. Tata was certainly one such enterprising leader who had an iconic stature. G.R.D. Tata was a thought leader. When G.R.D. Tata took over the position as chairman, he decided to try and emulate Jamsetji's philosophy, which is to think about the nation's needs first. It was the great leadership qualities of G.R.D. Tata that made the organization culture-oriented rather than compliance-oriented. Even though G.R.D. Tata used to regret his lack of university degree, he relied on his self-education and followed the below approaches and converted his lack of confidence of not having a formal education into phenomenal strengths. He got the best out of his employees by letting them exploit their own instincts and intervened only when he thought they were going wrong. That way, he enabled his employees. He respected expertise. He never hesitated to consult experts. He made sure to arrive at decisions based on information and opinion he received and waited for the superior knowledge of his advisors to confirm his decisions wherever required. He also combined trust with achievement. He trusted people and chose achievement over power and control. He made sure his desire for consensus did in no way affect his drive for achievement. The three leadership qualities acquired by G.R.D. Tata from Jamsetji can be enumerated as follows. 1. Vision of the future. 2. Integrity of thought and mind. 3. Humanity. G.R.D. Tata always believed in diversity of people, their thoughts and styles rather than groupthink. G.R.D. Tata's philosophy has always been, what is good for India is good for Tata's. G.R.D. Tata was a critical thinker. He always had the foresight to appreciate potential opportunities. He was first to take advantage of them to benefit the company and its employees. He never waited for things to happen. Rather, he anticipated them and responded to them. From aviation, tourism was one great example. He never ceased to find new potentials. As an aviator, when he saw the aviation industry flourishing, he also saw that along with it, the economy has a potential for tourism industry to boom too. He started the planning and implementing expansion of Taj Group of hotels. In 20 years, the Taj Group had 40 hotels in India and abroad. From soda ash to other industries, when the Maharaja of Baroda saw the potential of Tata's to produce inorganic chemicals, G.R.D. Tata grabbed the opportunity as he saw India's self-reliance in the manufacture of glass, ceramic, textiles, etc. Even though Tata Chemicals faced very many hurdles, G.R.D. Tata never gave up, which led to the high annual production which I stated earlier. In 1936, due to controls by the government, Tata's had to sell out the stake of ACC, Associated Cement Companies. But when the opportunity emerged in 1988, Tata Chemicals and Tata Group acquired significant holdings in ACC. He was a leader of fair sense. He never sought high offices. G.R.D. was a leader of conviction and integrity who politely rejected several offers, some of them listed below, from governments during his active years without upsetting the governments. The chairmanship of Hindustan Aircraft Limited, Bangalore. the chairmanship of domestic airline when Air India was nationalized, Indian delegation to the United Nations twice, president of IATA, although he accepted the office later, chairman of Monazite Sand Project in Travancore. G.R.D. Tata politely rejected the chairmanship of HAL offered by the then Defence Minister Baldev Singh, stating that it would not be wise for the two companies, that is Air India and HAL, to have a common chairman. As we can recall, those were the years of labour strife or volatile industrial relations. But G.R.D. Tata's way of engaging with the employees made sure that labour relations at Tata Group companies were always cordial. G.R.D. Tata believed when one cultivates a liking for and trust in the one who deals with, it is really not difficult to establish a good relation between management, workers and their union. The three most important requirements for getting along with people as per G.R.D. Tata were as follows. 1. Communication. It was clearly evident from the relationship established between the steel company and the union at Jamshedpur that frank and continuous engagement ensured high morale. 2. Honesty. G.R.D. Tata emphasized on the need for total honesty and sincerity in dealing with people, as he was aware of the disastrous consequences of mistrust among people in the human history. And finally, trust. As per G.R.D. Tata, only trusting people will inspire similar response in them. The Tata Workers Union registered their protest against government's decision to nationalize Tata Steel, and later in the same year, the company celebrated 50 years of industrial harmony. Institutional support for labor relations. G.R.D. Tata's vision for healthy and salubrious industrial relations was not one which was personalized. While that was his personal mission, professional mission, he also made sure that it was institutionalized in his companies. G.R.D. Tata's vision held that communication should take place across the board, and hence the personnel department in Tata's was established in 1947. He ensured good and cooperative relations within the company by taking care of the following. In the mid-1950s, Tata's took significant step in associating their workers with the running of their departments. Two historic agreements were signed in the year 1956, which set out basic rights and obligations of management and employees. The agreements ensured closer association of the employees with the departmental councils, where management and employees could discuss their problems regularly. Each council would have an equal number of representatives from management and employees. The joint councils used to decide on the entire spectrum of labor and industrial problems as and when they arose. The companies of Tata Group enjoyed industrial peace for nearly 5 decades of G.R.D.'s tenure as chairman. He was a team builder par excellence, the man who nurtured a talent pool for India. He was firm in demanding standards, he was generous in giving credits, and he was liberal in empowering his deputies. He was a team builder, therefore, beyond any compare. His teams always had an emotional connection with him. They never hesitated to approach him for any issues. Tata Group under G.R.D. Tata voluntarily took up the responsibility of nurturing a talent pool for India through the group companies. That way he was a national builder too. G.R.D. Tata used to choose most of his important team members by himself. He gave them tremendous flexibility and got the best out of them. He encouraged individual leaders to build competencies beyond requirements. We discussed charismatic leadership in one of the earlier lectures. G.R.D. Tata is an exemplary illustration of what charismatic leadership would all be. Tata Sons and later Tata Industries were managing agents of all Tata companies. While the profits were shared, Tata's never took a percentage of turnover when the company performed badly. Max Weber, a German sociologist, developed the concept of charismatic authority, meaning a type of leadership derived from the charisma of the leader as discussed in our previous lecture. G.R.D. Tata was a leader with charismatic authority as demonstrated by the seamlessly persuasive manner G.R.D. held sway over several organizations. Until 1970, the managing agency system enabled legal formal authority for G.R.D. Tata to rule and carry the entire empire of Tata's on his shoulders. When the managing agency system was abolished and the companies became independent, it posed a major challenge not only for G.R.D. Tata but also for his managers for unified running of affairs. But then there was a sense of unity continuing to knit the various companies together. This was because J.R.D. Tata was a charismatic Democrat who never imposed himself on his chief executives. When the managing agency system was terminated, 74% of Tata Group companies was run by managing agencies. With the help of noted lawyer Nani Palkhiwala, J.R.D. Tata was able to restructure each and every company of Tata's. Such a transformative change would not have taken place but for the charismatic authority he had over all of his companies. He was also a nationalist. He scripted a great prescription for independent India. The Bombay Plan was the prescription prepared by J.R.D. Tata along with seven other industrialists in 1944-1945 for thee to be independent India, to drive into an era of industrialization and economic growth. While the first Prime Minister, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, did not formally accept the plan, the governmental policies did reflect the Bombay Plan. It was written by Dr. John Mathai with considerable discussion with J.R.D. Tata. It proposed a 15-year period of development divided into plans of 5-year span. You can recall that the 5-year planning process started after India's independence. So you can say that one of the important aspects of the Bombay Plan was implemented by the Government of India. As chairman of Air India, J.R.D. Tata made a report on comparison methods of organization, management and control of stock keeping between Air India and the Indian Air Force. Even today, this report of J.R.D. Tata is said to be a compulsory read for all chiefs of the Indian Air Force. Aircraft ancillary electronic equipment required by the defense services, written as part of the plan, contained detailed recommendations on the equipment and expansion of the Indian Air Force for the next 10 years. The Economics and Statistics Department, built since 1940s, made available comprehensive figures on food consumption, cloth consumption, average lifespan of an Indian, etc. The report laid foundation on the emphasis of economic measures. Even 30 years after the Bombay Plan was documented, it seemed contemporary and highly intellectual. H.V.R. Iyengar, himself a very intellectual governor of Reserve Bank of India, stated that he had been reading the plan and was amazed by the fact that conceptually it remained very modern even for the 1970s. He was a person of adaptive leadership. It was unheard of in those times that a private sector industrialist could head a public sector corporation. In respect of J.R.D. Tata, it was even more unique as he agreed to head the nationalized Air India as non-executive chairman. This represented the respect J.R.D. commanded and the emotive attachment he had for the aviation company that he set up. With Air India, prior to nationalization, J.R.D. Tata was a more free leader as he was creating something new. Post-nationalization, his passion was to preserve the legacy. He changed his style to operating through the managing director while retaining the touch with employees and customers. He continued to enable progressive decisions on fleet expansion, operational efficiency and the like. And within Tata Group, J.R.D. Tata continued to be a visionary leader as he had to further expand the Tata empire. He was conscious not to destroy anything important that was created in the past while creating new entities. We talked about change with continuity as being the success factor for Tata. We can realize from this that J.R.D. Tata also modeled change with continuity. He always took decisions consulting others and respected their judgment. Despite the huge expansion in Tata Group, he never diluted the self-created code of conduct and value systems. J.R.D. Tata was emotionally involved with Air India even after nationalization and the subsequent removal from the board. A true leader, he remained committed to the cause rather than his personal status. I always told you as part of my earlier lectures that we should be loyal to a cause rather than to the boss. And this is what happened. He was loyal to the cause that he espoused, that he established and that he grew. He was a leader of empathy. J.R.D. Tata always believed in leading people with affection. This is what made him a great leader loved by many. A few examples. He volunteered to send an officer of his to America for chemotherapy for taking care of cancer and made sure all his travel and money needs were taken care of. He never gave up calling and talking to J.D. Choksi, a beloved leader of his, until he passed away in the hospital. He took endless trouble in finding a job in Sweden for an Indian Army brigadier whose Swedish wife was getting treated in her country for her illness. Like a father, he advised to rehearse and gave his tape recorder to D.R. Pindsey, a Cambridge-educated economist who was to address an international conference in London. Leadership is all about having the ability to relate, connect, listen, and bond with people with the purpose of and inspire and empowering their life. J.I.D. Tata was an empathetic leader who proved time and again that empathy is what elicits loyalty. J.I.D. Tata can be described very nicely as a democratic capitalist. Arun Mehra, the former member of the Planning Commission, was with the Tata Group for 25 years. He recently wrote a succinct tribute to J.I.D. Tata, calling him the democratic capitalist. Some experts from his article are cited below. J.I.D. picked leaders who dared to build in India and who had the passion to learn fast too. Jamsetji Tata, the founder of the Tata Group, was a role model for him. J.I.D. Tata was known to be a people's man. Every employee in the far-flung Tata empire could write directly to the chairman if he or she felt that their managers were not living up to Tata values. Values were very important for J.I.D. Tata. J.I.D. believed that workers are the backbone of industrial enterprises. He personally wrote a manifesto of a human enterprise to guide all Tata companies. J.I.D. believed that good human relations are not built on paternalist principles. He believed that workers must have the right to speak to their managers as equals when matters of principle or fundamental rights are involved. Tata's test of a good policy was whether or not it would be good for India and Indians before considering whether or not it was good for Tata's. J.I.D. Tata, therefore, was a democratic capitalist in the true sense of the term. Mahatma Gandhi said once that while he was fighting for India's political freedom, Jamshedji Tata was fighting for India's economic freedom. After India won its independence from the British, J.I.D. Tata carried both flags. He continued Jamshedji's mission to build world-class industries to make in India. And he was also a champion of the political rights of India's workers to form good unions within Tata Enterprises. He also had impeccable social responsibility. J.I.D. Tata was the driving force for Tata Group's progressive and proactive corporate social responsibility approach. His CSR approach comprised industry-leading employee welfare measures and community welfare measures. As the trustee of Sir Dorabji Tata Trust in 1932, he played an active role in several philanthropic and social activities. The corporate social responsibility activities of Tata Group are so varied that it is impossible to capture them here. However, I will make a few mentions. In healthcare, every Tata company with township had excellent healthcare facilities, including top-class hospitals. I have personally seen in the 1970s as an employee of Telco, the kind of hospital infrastructure that was built by the Tatas in Jamshedpur. Tata Memorial Hospital is certainly a landmark contribution to healthcare infrastructure in those times. Community services. J.I.D. Tata encouraged all Tata Group companies adopt the contiguous villages and provide free education, healthcare and sanitation services. Tata Steel adopted over 250 villages in the 1960s itself. And the trusts which Tata Group had or Tata Sons had rendered human service. Apart from strengthening the Sir Dorabji Trust, he sold off his assets and established a trust in his mother's name. The much appreciated Population Atlas of India and the Atlas of the Child in India were published by the Population Foundation. J.I.D. Tata, by donating his own shares of Tata Sons and other companies, started the J.I.D. Tata Trust in 1944. His own personal belongings were nothing but an apartment and a little cash. Everything else was for the Tata Trust. As the following chart shows, the seeds of philanthropy sown by Tata Trust continued to grow over the decades. Tata Trust is a formidable group of philanthropic institutions of the Tata Group, which grew over the 125 plus years of the group's initiatives on this front. The early foundations laid by Sir Dorabji were strengthened by J.I.D. Tata during his tenure. The Trust saw further growth in Ratan Tata's tenure. The graphic below illustrates. 1892 was the first scheme, J.N. Tata Endowment Scheme, and every few years a trust started getting added. The trusts operate in 15 areas. One cluster is healthcare, nutrition, education, livelihood, water, sanitation, and hygiene related. Another cluster dealt with the digital transformation, migration and urban habitat, social justice and inclusion, environment and energy, and skill development. Another one related to sports, arts and culture, disaster relief and rehabilitation, institutions and individual grants programs. The funds disbursed moved up from 76 crores, 2000 crores in 2018-19. GRD Tata commenced the healthy habit of Tata Group companies donating a small part of their earnings to Tata Trust so that they can carry out impactful activities. The trusts are thus playing a significant role in COVID-19 area too. Tata Group collaborated with various scientific agencies to come up with very affordable rapid COVID tests. GRD Tata also believed that men who contribute to the progress of the company deserve to be in the highest office. He graciously made way and gave up his chairmanship of individual companies and even of the group to the other deserving leaders in the system. GRD Tata voluntarily gave up the chairmanship of Telco to Sumant Pulgaonkar when he was 68. At 78, he gave up the chairmanship of Tata Chemicals to Dabari Seth. 2 years later, at 80, he gave up the chairmanship position of Tata Steels to Rusi Modi. And in 1981, GRD Tata appointed Ratan Tata, son of his distant cousin Naval Tata, as the chairman of Tata Industries, a 100% owned subsidiary of Tata Sons. As GRD made his deputies rather unassailable satraps, the transition process and succession processes set in motion by GRD, including succession of his own position by Ratan Tata, brought certain level of turbulence. Yet, GRD as the father figure ensured group cohesion and stability. As the earlier lecture considered, the way Ratan Tata moved into GRD's startup position at the helm is itself an exemplary episode of transition with mentorship. Ratan Tata considered GRD Tata as his greatest mentor. He expressed that GRD Tata was like a father figure who mentored him during the rough times. One important lesson that Ratan Tata inherited from GRD Tata was his humility. There have been several books on and by GRD Tata. Four important books are shown here. GRD Tata read a wide variety of technical books and magazines and could follow technical details with a high level of competence. He was empathetic and perspicacious in his speeches and writings. There have been many books on GRD Tata, The Phenomenon. Two important books are mentioned below, along with two works on his expressions. GRD Tata Letters, Beyond the Last Blue Mountain, Keynote, and Jeff, The Life of GRD Tata. These are all the books on him. I have taken certain extracts from the books to present to you as part of this lecture. A legendary leadership saga of GRD Tata cannot be summarized obviously in a brief lecture with limited number of slides. Perusal of the above works will provide you with additional insights. One thing which I would like to highlight towards the end of this lecture is that in terms of conglomerate leadership, there have been excellent guiding principles from GRD Tata. His leadership journey at the helm of Tata Group of 5 decades brings out several principles of conglomerate leadership that synthesize and integrate the 30 leadership competencies that I proposed and discussed in this course throughout. It is also an integration of the 10 leadership models that I presented to you, and that happened in GRD Tata's case in one holistic sweep. The 30 leadership competencies comprised developmental, performance, and apex leadership competencies. Under the developmental cluster, we had trust, empathy, passion, courage, integrity, mentorship, empowerment, reflection, aspiration, and commitment. Each of these developmental leadership attributes were in place with GRD Tata. In terms of performance leadership competencies, knowledge, vision, strategy, execution, conceptual skills, analytical skills, decisiveness, communication, collaboration, and negotiation were the top qualities, and GRD Tata possessed all of these. As far as the apex leadership traits are concerned, wisdom, stature, innovation, intuition, inspiration, nurturing, networking, ethics, objectivity, and socioeconomic purpose top the list. And GRD Tata was clearly the tallest industrial leader that India ever had. And in terms of the leadership models, all of the leadership models that I have presented to you were seen in J.R.D. Tata's leadership of Tata Group. He was a pioneer in his leadership. He was performance oriented in his leadership. He ensured longevity for the company. He held reins for over 50 years and grew the conglomerate from 14 enterprises to 95 enterprises. He provided solid intellectual leadership to the group, and he was accountable in terms of his own values, his own code of conduct. He was a charismatic leader who influenced the communities, who influenced the employees, who influenced the leaders in a very positive way with his empathy and with his frank and candid way of interaction. He was certainly a people-oriented leader. Follower leadership was part of his leadership profile. He was allowing his people to be independent, yet also provided a dependency relationship when they needed. Independence leadership was therefore one of the highlights of his leadership. And he was a leader who was connected all through his professional leadership career. Even when Air India got nationalized, he stayed connected with the airlines. He stayed connected with India's problems. Before India became independent, he stayed connected with a vision of developing India into a great power. He was connected with every leader of his conglomerate, and he maintained personal touch with every leader. And he also ensured that any employee of the group could reach out to him if there was a circumstance that needed that employee to reach out to him. And his leadership can be described as an integrative conglomerate leadership model. I might have described these 30 leadership competencies, 10 leadership models. All of that is summarized, illustrated, and executed by J.R.D. Tata in his 50 plus years of conglomerate leadership model, which I call J.R.D. Tata's integrative conglomerate leadership model. We discussed earlier that not all leaders have all competencies in equal measure, and that the leadership models are applied contextually. J.R.D. Tata, as a great iconic leader, had the total competency spectrum with an integrated conglomerate leadership mega model. He is a leader beyond any compare in India's industry and in India's economy. He brought great repute to not only Tata Group, but also to Indian industry and to the Indian economy. With this, we come to the end of this lecture. Hope to see you in the next lecture. Thank you.